Hi, I'm Pia. I'm an economic researcher and I teach macroeconomics. In this video, we're going to learn about how markets work and the forces of supply and demand. In order to do so, we're going to start by defining a perfectly competitive market. This will allow us to develop the concepts of the demand curve and the supply curve. And finally, we will put everything together and see how markets actually work. With this content, you'll be able to understand how demand interacts with supply and the role of price. So let's begin. First of all, we need to begin by defining and constructing the market. A market consists of a group of buyers and sellers of a particular good or service. Those buyers are the ones who will construct the demand, and the sellers will become the supply. The first type of market we're going to study in this video is perfectly competitive. What does this mean? First of all, it means there are plenty of buyers and sellers. This means that one individual consumer or producer will not generate significant changes in the market with his own behavior. It also means that no individual or entity has great power or influence in this market. Also, goods for sale are equal, which means that the sellers produce the same product. So there is no distinctive feature in the products that generates influence among buyers. And finally, everyone is a price taker. So, moving on with demand, as we just said, demand is composed by the group of buyers of a certain good or service. In this section, we will construct the demand curve. As with every curve, it is determined by at least two variables, in this case, quantity, Q, and price, P. The quantity demanded is the amount of product that buyers are willing and able to purchase. And price is the amount of money required in exchange for that product. This is negatively related to quantity, since the higher the price, the lower the quantity demanded, and vice versa. Let's illustrate this in a graph. This is a basic graph which shows us the demand curve. As you may see, its slope is negative because of the inverse relationship between price and quantity. Let's imagine you are thirsty, walking on the street and you want to buy a soda. On the street you see from afar a couple of shops, so you enter the first one. You find the soda you want, but it is worth $30. That seems like a lot for a soda, doesn't it? The curve illustrates that if soda is $30, hardly anyone will buy that. So you walk to the next shop, and the same soda is worth $2. That seems about right, and point B in the curve reflects that for $2, more people will buy soda. However, before you go to the counter, you see from across the street that another shop has the same soda for sale at $1. So you leave that $2 soda and cross to the other shop. See point C? At this point, with soda at half the price, the quantity demanded will be significantly higher. So far, we've seen how the curve is constructed and that it represents the addition of all the consumers of one product. We've also seen that with changes in price, the quantity demanded will change, causing displacements along the curve. But there are more variables that affect the demand curve, and changes in those variables can affect the shape of the curve or even generate the curve to shift. For example, the price of related products. Imagine the old price increased by 500%. Do you think people will still be buying cars in the same way? Consumer states of preference may change as well. This could be seasonal, like buying less ice cream during winter, or changes in fashion trends, or tastes changing due to an aging population. Income is also a relevant variable. What would you think would happen if everyone started earning twice as much as today? For example, let's try with people start earning twice as much, and we are analyzing the demand of cars. What would happen to the demand curve? The curve would shift to the right. See that for price X, now the quantity demanded would increase from QA to QB. QB is higher, so the new changes in income caused an exogenous increase in the quantity demanded. Now let's discuss the supply curve. At first, this is quite similar than the case for demand. Instead of a group of buyers of a certain good or service, we are now talking about a group of sellers. The supply is composed by the sellers of a certain product, and its quantity is the amount they are willing and able to sell. But this curve is positively related to price. The higher the price sold, the higher the quantity that suppliers will be willing to sell. Now the logic is inverse. With that in mind, let's take a look at this chart. What are the differences between point A and point B? As you may see, suppliers are willing to sell more in point B because the price is higher. So what makes the supply curve shift? Mainly changes in the input prices and capacity of technology. Those will be changes in exogenous variables, for example, increasing wages or oil prices. For example, let's imagine that the price for oil increases and we are analyzing the supply for milk. At first, it may seem that oil has nothing to do with milk. However, the suppliers need oil for transportation and distribution. Oil is an input price for milk. This then will cause the supply curve to shift to the left, which means that at the same price, the quantity supplied will be lower. This is represented by QB. So now all that we have left is to make those curves interact and understand how demand affects supply and vice versa. In other words, how do markets work? This graph puts everything together. Axis Y represents the price for a good, and axis X represents the quantity supplied and demanded for the product. Curve SC stands for the supply curve, sloped positively. And DC is the demand curve, sloped negatively. The intersection of the supply and demand curves is called the equilibrium. This is illustrated in point A. This shows us the equilibrium price, PA, at which the quantity that buyers are willing to buy is equal to the quantity that sellers are willing to sell. Now imagine that the market is not in equilibrium and the price is at PX, which is higher than PA. You can observe that at PX, the quantity demanded, QD, isn't the same as the quantity supplied, QS. It's actually lower. Notice the difference between QD and QS. This gap, or surplus, is known as excess supply. Now suppose that PX was actually lower, which in the graph shows us the opposite case. The quantity demanded, QD, exceeds the quantity supplied, QS. This consists on a shortage of output and is known as the excess demand. Let's see the whole dynamic with a quick exercise. Let's suppose that we are analyzing the market of pillows in country X. Country X has many companies that produce pillows as well as many consumers. The equilibrium point A shows us that given a price of $20, 1,000 pillows are being sold per year. Now suppose that there has been a technology improvement which allows all pillow producers to generate more output. What will happen to the supply curve because of the technology innovation? How is the new equilibrium reached? The supply curve will shift to the right because of the improvements in technology. This allows for more productivity and higher output. Knowing that the price hasn't changed, we arrive at point B, which represents an imbalance since there is an excess of supply. Now the situation is as follows. The price for pillows is still $20, aggregate demand for pillows is still 1,000, but producers are able to produce more, and at $20, they are willing to sell more pillows. So how do we reach equilibrium? The displacement will now occur along the supply curve until we reach a price that equals the quantity supplied with the quantity demanded. That's how we arrive at point C. this is the new equilibrium. As you may see, price had to decrease in order for consumers to start demanding more and meet the new production capacity that suppliers had. Which are the most common mistakes? First of all, remember that changes in price and quantity do not make the supply and demand curves shift, since they are endogenous variables. If they change, we are moving along the supply and demand curves. However, changes in exogenous variables, such as consumer preferences or input prices, lead to curve shifts. This generates a new price and a new quantity when we reach the new equilibrium. Wrapping up, we've seen in this video that a market of a certain good or service is composed by buyers and sellers with perfect competition. When the buyer's plans meet the seller's plans, the quantity demanded equals the quantity supplied at a certain price. This is called an equilibrium. Now think about your daily exchanges. Do you think that fashion alters prices? Do some goods become more attractive when they become more expensive? Hope you have enjoyed this video. And also, if you want to learn more about the topic, feel free to explore on Chegg.